Your DNA is composed of millions of individual nucleotide bases, with each base forming a pair with their opposite to make that classic double helix structure we know and love. Within our 23 chromosomes, there are an estimated 3 trillion of these AT and GC pairs, making it one of the most comprehensive and prehistoric collections of data known to man. Within these 3 trillion base pairs, there are about 100,000 genes, each with a unique sequence of around 1,000 nucleotide pairs. For those of you not keeping track at home, this means that out of our 3 trillion base pairs, our genes make up an astonishingly small 3% of our total genome and exist interspersed between millions of non-coding sequences. If you were to record on paper the entire genome of one person, you would have to use more than 175 books or 262,000 pages of densely printed text. Now imagine you're a scientist trying to study just one of those 100,000 genes. After sequencing and scanning each of those 262,000 pages to confirm that your subject has the gene, well, your research is now irrelevant. So scientists have come up with an ingenious way to search and find specific DNA sequences within our never-ending code without having to sequence the entire genome. Gel electrophoresis for genotyping is the process of testing for the presence of a specific DNA sequence within our genome. Scientists first amplify a region of DNA using a PCR machine. They then weigh out segments of DNA and compare those segments to a pre-existing set of DNA to see if their gene of interest is present. If it is present, the scientists should see a recognizable band on an electrophoresis gel and can continue on with their research. The actual process of genotyping can be done in under a day, and it's a common practice in pretty much every biology lab. It is one of the first things a researcher learns how to do, and is essentially a gauntlet into the world of research. That being said, it is still an incredibly complex and intimidating procedure, especially for a new scientist. So today I wanted to go through my process of doing gel electrophoresis, but note that every scientist does it in a slightly different way depending on their equipment. To begin genotyping, you need a DNA sample. For your typical rat or mouse subject, scientists take a sample from the end of the tail, toenail, or their ear. I do ear because the small cut left in their ear can be used to identify the subject later on. Adding about 100 milliliters of 50 millimolar sodium hydroxide and heat will induce a process called alkaline lysis. The sodium hydroxide base not only breaks down the cell wall surrounding the DNA, but weakens the hydrogen bonds between the two strands of DNA, thus converting it to a single strand. After heating the sample for about 1 hour, I stop the reaction by adding 30 milliliter of tris hydrochloric acid, which will work to restore the pH of the solution. Now I will prepare the sample. In a mini test tube, I add 8 microliters of deionized water, followed by 1 microliter of primer, which is specific to each region of DNA I am interested in finding. Within each primer, there are copies of both the forward and reversed genetic region of interest so that it will attach to both the sense and antisense DNA strands. Using a different pipette for each transfer so I don't cross-contaminate, I then add 6 microliters of the master mix, which is just a pre-mixed solution of products the DNA will need in order to self-replicate, such as DNA polymerase, magnesium chloride, and some more buffers. And finally, I add 1 microliter of the extracted DNA to each sample. And once I have the DNA and primers all mixed up, now I get to sit back and let technology take over for amplification. Amplification just refers to the process of replicating a specific region of DNA. It's sort of like searching for a needle in a haystack, but you have a magical self-replicating needle, making your chance of finding at least one needle a lot higher. This PCR, short for polymerase chain reaction, amplifies DNA by cycling through a series of different temperatures as pre-programmed by yours truly. I'm not going to go into detail about what's going on inside the PCR, because there are a lot of resources out there which animate the whole process better than I could explain it, but I'll link a few of my favorite videos in the description. After about 2 hours, we now have an amplified portion of DNA, meaning that that needle in a haystack is starting to look more like some hay in a stack of needles. Now to move on to my favorite part of genotyping, identifying the gene. This is the last step, and all I need to do is weigh out the DNA fragments by drifting them through an electrophoresis gel, which is what I'm making right now. The gel is made by mixing TAE with agarose and boiling it in a microwave for a few minutes. Oh, and general rule of science, always assume glass is hot, especially when it just came out of the microwave. It is then left on the counter to cool down for a few minutes before I add a fluorescent dye that will allow the DNA to be visible once they are added to the gel. The dye is covered in tin foil because fluorescence is sensitive to light. So for the remainder of this project, I'm going to make sure to cover the gel with tin foil whenever I can. Next, I pour the solution into this mold where it will cool for about 15 more minutes until it becomes a solid gel. These prongs are placed in it to leave a hole where DNA can sit once the gel is fully solid. Now that the gel is solid, I transfer it to a plastic tray attached to an electrical rig. Once I remove these prongs, you will be able to see the wells that they made in the gel where the DNA will be able to sit. To briefly review how electrophoresis works, the rig is attached to a machine which will send charged particles from the negative side to the positive side. If you think of the electromagnetic waves as little tiny worker ants traveling across a plate, you could imagine they find a piece of food, pick it up, and carry it down a plate. An ant carrying a breadcrumb will pick it up and move quite quickly, while an ant carrying an entire walnut, if that's even possible, will pick it up, carry it, but move much slower as it drags the walnut behind him. This is similar to the charged particles traveling across the gel and picking up fragments of DNA as they travel. Larger DNA segments will travel slower and shorter, lighter segments will travel quickly. But by stopping the charged particles before they can carry them completely off the gel, we can approximate how large the DNA is based on its rate of movement through the gel. Knowing that charged particles will be flowing through the rig, I need a non-air medium through which they can flow. Again, I just use TAE. I then load about 5 microliters of DNA sample into each of the separate wells, and then I'm ready to start the machine. Putting on the lid, it is important that I orient it with the negative end at the beginning and the positive end at the end. That way the charged particles will flow in the correct direction. Once I start the machine, I can actually see the charged particles leaving from the negative end, so I go ahead and cover it with a tinfoil lid and let it run for about 20 minutes. Once this process was complete, I saw these really nice bands in the gel. There are actually 2 bands because certain dyes give rise to 2 components with different electrophoretic mobilities. They don't actually interfere with our ability to read the data though, so it's not really something to worry about. Now at this point you might be thinking, okay, I see some lines, but what does that mean? The bands don't actually mean anything on their own, but when you add a UV light and compare it to an identified set of DNA, referred to as a ladder, you can make conclusions about what the genes you are looking at actually are. I take the finished gel and load it into this machine so it can be read under UV lighting. It's important to note that for this run-through, I didn't use the ladder I was talking about earlier, and that's just because this was a sample and I didn't want to waste any of the expensive material. With only 3 samples, the results of this one aren't that exciting, so here are a few of my favorites from previous experiments. And at the end of it all, throwing away this gel is almost as exciting as getting some good results. Almost.